So to what extent does a college degree mean richer paydays? Well, the degrees associated with the highest paychecks fall under these four letters, STEM, which stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And on average, STEM-related jobs pay almost $35,000 more annually than the average American wage, as you can see. So what does it take to get one of these good jobs? Well, 97% of STEM jobs will require some post-secondary education, while 56% of all STEM jobs will require a bachelor's degree or higher. Yet, once someone has actually attained those skills, the demand for these jobs is only going to grow. Over the next 10 years, Oklahoma is on track to replace 42% of our existing STEM workforce. It's also expected our state will rank 30th in the nation in STEM job growth between the same time period. So how do we get there? Well, that is the question a group of Oklahomans try to answer in a new report called One Oklahoma. Earlier, I sat down with the group's chair, physicist and Oklahoma Secretary of Technology, Stephen McKeever. Well, Dr. McKeever, I have the report here with me, and it almost reads like a strategic plan.
That's exactly what it is. It's a strategic plan for the development of science and technology, in particular industry, within the state. So it's an economic development plan.
And it was developed both with educators and industry input.
Exactly. University, industry, and the financial sector were the main contributors to the report.
Give me the overall view of what you found when you took a look at STEM education here in the state.
Well, first of all, let me say that the development of a science and technology infrastructure requires consideration at several different levels. But the underlying level, the base upon which it's all built, is STEM education. And STEM education is the core of the workforce that we will need to support our industries in the science and technology sector. So when we looked at the numbers coming through our education system, we found that we weren't producing enough to support the growth of the industries in the future. And then we started to ask the question, why? What are the issues here? And it appears that, well, as you know, as a fifth grader, you show me a fifth grader that doesn't like dinosaurs or spacecraft. So everybody at a young age loves science. They really do, whether they call it that or not. But then if you were to look at the numbers of those who say that they have aspirations to a science career as a function of time, as a function of their age, all the way through college, there's a steady decline in interest. Now that's worrying. Another aspect is if you look at the ACT scores in science and math over the last decade, they haven't shifted. They're all round about the same numbers, year after year, despite all of the various education reforms that we've had over the years. So clearly something is the issue. Well, there's one thing that is common to all reports and investigations into education, and that is the most critical person is the teacher. And so we focused our attention on the teacher, how to make them better, and in particular, how to get away from this notion that teaching is a vocation. It's not a vocation, it is a profession. It is a professional career.
So I think it's interesting that you say that, because a lot of times people say, well, I teach because I love to teach, but you think there needs to be other incentives for people to teach in the STEM field.
Absolutely. I mean, why punish somebody because they love to do what they do? Why say that because you love to teach, we don't have to pay you enough? The fact of the matter is that teachers have families too, and they have to survive too. And we're not competing with other schools when we consider the salaries of our teachers. We're competing with industry. So somebody who's highly qualified in a science or technology or mathematics area has the choice between a starting salary of, let's say, 45,000, 46,000 in industry and 30,000 in teaching.
And you also talk about teaching methods, and one of them is to modernize STEAM teaching methods at your colleges and universities. This from a physicist and a college professor. How did that come about?
Indeed. Well, at universities, we've been struggling with the best way to teach very large classes. And it's a continuing dialogue at universities. We are always coming across this question. But one of the things about education in general, and I don't care whether you talk about college or high school or wherever it might be, education has a terrible reputation for reinventing the wheel. We tend to do endless studies about what's the best way to teach. Well, enough already. We've done a lot of research, and there is a lot of evidence out there that some of the traditional methods may not be the best, and some of the newer methods may well be much better. And so we're calling for a reconsideration of those traditional methods. Let's have a serious look, because the data is already out there. The research has already been done. The results are already in. There's plenty for us to look at without having to do another research effort into how to teach.
Is there a way to bring people from industry into the classroom?
Always. One of the benefits of that, especially at the younger level, in the, let's say, K through 12 in general, is that we will be telling and showing the kids what kind of career is available to them in the future. Many of them don't know what you can do with, let's say, a physics qualification or a chemistry qualification. They simply don't know what's out there, what's available. So to get professionals, industry professionals, to come into the classroom to illustrate what it is that is open to them is very valuable.
So we have the STEM college graduates. We get them into our classrooms. Then what happens?
Well, what we have to do is convert that vocation that I talked about into a profession. And one of the ways that we can do that is to have a career ladder for the teachers to go up. For example, currently, if a teacher enters the profession and then retires 35, 40 years later, they retire at exactly the same rank as they entered 35 or 40 years ago. And the reason for that is that there is no other rank for them to go to. Now, in higher education, we solved that problem many years ago, where we have assistant professors, then the next stage up, if you perform, associate professors, and then full professors and regents professors. Industry has a similar career ladder, but teaching does not. If you need to get a higher salary in teaching, you have to get out of the classroom and into administration. So let's have a career structure for our teachers, an entry level, followed by a more senior level. And then perhaps if you're a head of department, a science department, say, you can go to another level, but you have to perform and you have to apply for those promotional steps. And I'm not talking about annual salary increases. I'm talking about real promotional increases so that the teachers have a career in front of them that they can go for.
Almost team leaders.
Absolutely.
Dr. Stephen McKeever, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure.
And I continue my conversation with Oklahoma's Secretary of Technology, Dr. Stephen McKeever, on our website. Just go to okhorizon.com and click on this week's Value Added.